My goodness, what a quiet assembly you are. I feel like, I should say, the Lord be with you, and we begin. I want to say a word of welcome to all of you to Duke Divinity School, Duke Divinity students, visitors from various places who've come here tonight. We are going to have a panel discussion this evening about the theology of Paul. Just a few details about organization. I think the website may have had an announcement that said it would run from 7:30 to 9:30, but the panelists have agreed we're going to stop at 9, so it'll be an hour and a half with no intermission, no halftime. And one of the advantages of that is that the bookstore down at the other end of this hallway out here is going to remain open until 9:30. So if some of you want to buy books by our distinguished guest or by the other authors on this panel, you'll have some opportunity to do so. You can decide whose books you're most interested in reading after this conversation. The approximate occasion for this is that we have with us Professor Tom Wright tonight, who is here speaking both at University of North Carolina and here at Duke. He will be giving a public lecture here in this same space in the Divinity School tomorrow at 12:30, called If Memory Serves, Why and How, or How and Why, Paul Invented Christian Theology, Why and How. Why and How Paul Invented Christian Theology, 12:30 tomorrow here in Goodson Chapel. Again, public invited to attend. I think those are the main announcements I need to make. Am I forgetting anything? Because of the relatively brief time that we have tonight, we don't expect that we're going to have time to do Q&A tonight, but we will be doing that at the end of the lecture tomorrow. There will be at least a short time for question and answer, but because we have a number of voices here on the panel who will be asking each other questions, that will be the format. So this is not intended as a review session of N.T. Wright's most recent book. It's a discussion about Pauline theology among a panel of Pauline scholars. But of course, the occasion for this discussion is the publication of his book, although, as you'll see in a moment, we have a number of other people here who've also had a few things to say about Paul in print. So let me, I'm going to give very brief introductions of our panelists, especially for those of you who may be visitors. Over here at this end of the table, we have Professor Douglas Campbell, who's professor of New Testament at Duke Divinity School. He has published a massive book, almost as big as the two volumes of Tom's most recent book, entitled The Deliverance of God, An Apocalyptic Rereading of Justification in Paul, and his most recent book, entitled Framing Paul, An Epistolary Biography, has appeared just this past week. It came off the press from Erdmann's. So, Doug... Professor Douglas Campbell. Professor Susan Eastman, Associate Research Professor of New Testament at the Divinity School. Her first book was entitled Recovering Paul's Mother Tongue, Language and Theology in Galatians. And she's currently working, she's on sabbatical leave actually and has come back to be with us this evening. She's working on a book on participation, imitation, and identity formation in Paul. Interestingly, in conversation with contemporary work in the fields of cognitive psychology and neuroscience. On this side, we have Professor Ross Wagner, Associate Professor of New Testament in the Divinity School. Ross has specialized not only in Paul's letters, but also on studies of the Septuagint, and is very interested in recovering theological exegesis through approaches to the way early Jews and Christians went about their interpretation of Scripture. His publications include a very important book on Romans entitled Heralds of the Good News, Paul and Isaiah in Concert in the Letter to the Romans. He edited a book called Between Gospel and Election, Explorations in the Interpretation of Romans 9 to 11. And his most recent book, which just came out just this past year, is called Reading the Sealed Book, Old Greek Isaiah and the Problem of Septuagint Hermeneutics. So those are, that's the home team here. The formidable visiting team, we have with us Professor N.T. Wright, former Bishop of Durham in the Church of England and now Professor of New Testament and Early Christianity at the University of St. Andrews, Scotland. I'm not going to begin to try to list all the books he has published. There are over 60 of them. But the most important ones I want to mention are the huge books that are all part of his series called the Christian Origins and the Question of God. Thank you, Tom. There are too many titles. I can't keep them all in my head. But this series includes the New Testament and the people of God, Jesus and the victory of God, the resurrection of the Son of God, and now most recently Paul and the faithfulness of God. The last thing I want to say is that something about the discussion we're about to have. That is that we are going to assume in many ways that this is the kind of discussion we might have if circumstances were more propitious, we might have around a dinner table with a good bottle of wine on the table. And we're not going necessarily to try to explain everything we might say to non-specialists. We're going to, you know, make some attempt to be conscious that we are having this conversation in public. But if you don't follow something, go read the books. Okay. So we've agreed roughly on some of the questions we're going to talk about, and we're going to give the opening innings to Tom to talk with us about the question of the return of Yahweh to Zion. One of the very distinctive features of his book, Paul and the Faithfulness of God, is the way in which he foregrounds the theme of the return of Yahweh to Zion as a key to Paul's Christology. And so we'd like you to explain what you mean by that, and then we'll get some responses from our panel.
Thanks, Richard, and thank you all for being here, and thanks especially to the panelists. They're all busy people, and for them to come and do this is an honor to me, and I'm very grateful for that, very cognizant of that. Also, apologies that on my body clock right now, it's 20 to 1 in the morning. I just got in yesterday, so granted we're talking about Paul, and Paul was somebody who could preach people out of the window in the middle of the night, you know. This is kind of a risk. So there we are. I'm going to try and stay awake, and I hope you will too. This particular theme, which I think is pretty important for Paul and for much of the New Testament, is not one which I have found elsewhere in contemporary scholarship. And that's always worrying, because as a New Testament scholar, the whole ground has been worked over so often. How can you possibly have something new to say? But over the last 20 years, as I have studied Second Temple Judaism, I've become aware that there's a kind of implicit narrative running through. Well, there are several narratives running through. And I'm not saying all Jews of the time believed this or that. I'm just saying that right the way through, there's a sense that something ought to happen which hasn't happened yet. And it goes like this, that in the book of Ezekiel, we are told that the Shekinah, the glory, the divine glory, left the temple and did a kind of a vertical takeoff, sat on the Mount of Olives for a while and then left. And nobody quite knew where the divine glory went to, but at the end of Ezekiel, it says that the temple will be rebuilt, and then finally the Shekinah, the divine glory, will return. And this idea of the divine glory going away and then coming back again through this time of exile actually has echoes in the Pentateuch, because in the Exodus narrative, the divine glory comes and guides the people through the wilderness, or starts to guide them through the wilderness, And then at the end of the book of Exodus, they build the tabernacle, and the Shekinah comes and dwells in the tabernacle. So this is both a return from exile motif and a new Exodus motif, and the two coalesce in all sorts of Second Temple texts where they resonate with one another. But here's the thing, nowhere in the entire Second Temple literature does anyone even attempt to say that there has been a scene like Exodus 40 or 1 Kings 8, or the prophesied scene at the end of Ezekiel. And yet Isaiah has it as a main theme that the Lord will come back, that Yahweh will return. The valleys are going to be filled in, the mountains are going to be flattened down, so that they'll roll out the red carpet so that God can come back at last. And then in the spectacular passage in Isaiah 52, immediately before the fourth servant song, we have the watchmen lifting up their voices and shouting for joy because in plain sight they see Yahweh returning to Zion. And it's quite simply the case that in no Second Temple text does anybody say that that event of the visible return of the divine glory has actually happened. Lots of them say it should happen. Malachi says the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. Zechariah says he's going to come back. Several subsequent post-biblical texts speak of the return. But it's very interesting, there's one rabbinic saying much later where they are comparing the first temple, Solomon's temple, with the second temple, and the second temple, they say, is not a patch on Solomon's temple, and they list several things that were different, one of which is that the second temple never had the Shekinah in it, that the glory never came back. That's kind of a sort of a generally known thing. Now, of course, that raises for us a puzzle. Why did they still go to the temple? And the answer is as the same reason that they go to the Western Wall today. It's the place of prayer. It's the place where God has made himself known, where he's promised to show up, and maybe he'll show up in some form or another. But there's a sense of puzzlement because the narrative is incomplete. The only place which seems to be pointing at some sort of equivalent to that is Ben Sira 24, which speaks of wisdom being sent from heaven, and wisdom coming and dwelling in the temple, and wisdom turns out to be Torah. So you have Shekinah, Torah, and it's actually all there in the form of the wisdom which you learn from the people in the temple, presumably. But nobody says that actually this great new Exodus moment has happened until we get beginning of Mark's Gospel, for instance, where you quote Isaiah 40 and Malachi 3, and then we see Jesus, and plenty of other places in the New Testament as well, which are picking up precisely this theme in order to explain who Jesus is. But then in Paul, again and again, and I could cite several passages, but just think of 2 Corinthians 3 and 4, for instance, which is working with the end of the book of Exodus, and then talks about seeing the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And that's just one of many instances, and I discuss them in detail in the book, where to my surprise I found myself arguing, not only does Paul have what in the trade we call an early high Jewish Christology, but that he isn't doing this by looking at Jesus and gradually thinking, wow, maybe he's actually divine, but that he's telling a story about Israel's God coming back and finding that to do that you have to talk about Jesus. This is, if you like, a Christology from above, not just a Christology from below, and I'm in debate with various scholars about that. I could go on, but I won't. Just a tailpiece, this is also true about Paul's language about the Spirit. When I was younger, people used to say, maybe they still do, that in the New Testament they never really work out who the Spirit is and how all that comes together, and that it's only with the 4th and 5th century fathers that we really get a full theology of the Spirit's divinity. I think that's quite wrong. In Romans 8, the Spirit is the one who leads the people through the wilderness to the inheritance. But if you go back to the Exodus narrative, the one who leads the people through the wilderness to their inheritance is, of course, the pillar of cloud and fire, which is the personal presence of Israel's God himself. So that it seems to me Paul is using return of Yahweh language not only about Jesus, but also about the Spirit. And this, I think, is probably the most unusual or unexpected of the theological proposals in my book. And so naturally I'm interested to know what colleagues will say about it.
Panel?
Well, Yep, good, good to go. My response is, Are you really sure that Romans 8 has the new Exodus in the middle of it, Tom? Because I've not found it there myself. What I see structuring Romans 8 is the story that Paul quotes explicitly in Galatians, which is the contrast between Hagar and Ishmael, and Sarah and Isaac, which is a contrast between slavery and freedom, which is explicitly structured by a contrast between the flesh and the spirit. I think that explains all the data. So I'm not opposed in principle to the idea that Paul would be pulling a new Exodus narrative through into his text. I don't have a problem with that. That's fine. I'm just not sure if it's really there. Is there a text or a specific moment when you can put your finger on it and go, aha, and triumph, here it is?
As with many detections of echoes and allusions,
there is... The answer is no.
The case, as in many things, is cumulative, and the cumulative weight, I think, is massive. In Romans 6, people come through the waters, which means that though they started off as slaves, they end up as free. That's
yes.
An image which Paul refers to back again in 1 Corinthians 10, where baptism and the crossing of the Red Sea are brought together. Then what happens after that in the story of the Exodus is you arrive on Mount Sinai and get the Torah, which is what Romans 7 is all about. Then from there you journey on, and the Lord comes to dwell in the tabernacle in order to lead the people to the inheritance, the Kleronomia. Each one of those things is what you then find in 8. So I'm not saying that 8 by itself is an Exodus narrative. It seems, and this is, I too will bring in Galatians 4, but in this case, Galatians 4, 1 to 11, where you were slaves. When the time fully came, God did the act of liberation, so you were no longer slaves but sons. The theme of Son of God is an absolute spot on for Exodus, Israel is my son, my firstborn, and the result in Galatians 4, what do you mean maybe? It's there in the text of Exodus. Then in Galatians 4, 8 following, now that you have come to know God, this is very important that it's about, by my name Yahweh, I wasn't known to them, but you're going to discover who I really am. The revelation of who the true God is through the act of Exodus. And that is all in fulfillment of the promises to Abraham, which is what Galatians 3 was all about. So yeah, I think there's massive cumulative evidence, including some very sharp-edged specific points. So I'm not saying it's not about what you said, I just think that the Exodus... And it's partly that the Exodus narrative is so ubiquitous in so much Second Temple literature, under so many things, that it's something that could be drawn on this way and that. Anyway.
I would say there's massive ambiguity about all of this.
But you're basing this a lot through Romans 8 on baptism, aren't you, back in Romans 6?
Even if Romans 6 and 7 didn't exist, I think I would still say that when you see what Paul is doing in Romans 8, particularly the idea of being led to the inheritance and of being sons of God as Israel is, etc., there's a great accumulation there of Exodus motifs. This is, you know, other people have drawn attention to this as well.
No,
this isn't just me.
I think you're wrong. No, I think you missed. I mean, I actually think you got the wrong story, Tom. Shocking, but true. I think Genesis 22 is the story that's in play, because that's the story that structures the relationship between God and Christ in terms of Father and Son.
Clearly that is there.
And it's the one he quotes.
He actually quotes it. He quotes several things.
No, he quotes two things, and that's one of them.
He quotes
Psalm 40.
It's 8.
God who did not spare his only son, God, but delivered him up for us all. That's a quote from Genesis 22. It explains everything.
It's Romans 8, 32.
This is the birth of Trinitarian theology. You're going to need this for your lecture tomorrow.
What did you say?
This is the birth of Trinitarian theology.
Yeah. Well, I... I totally agree with that. That's a point of substantial agreement, I think, between Douglas and me, that, that what you see, good, precisely the way I was saying it, is exactly, if I had to say where did Trinitarian theology come from, I would start with Galatians 4 and continue quickly with Romans 8. I mean, it is all there. Obviously, Paul doesn't use that language, the word Trinity, whatever, but it's clearly a high theology of Jesus, a high theology of the Spirit, all in the service of the purpose of God. And I would also say one of the things that's going on in Exodus, or in the book of Exodus already, is the restoration of creation, the construction of the tabernacle, etc. And exactly what's happening at the end of Romans 8, that the creation itself will be set free from its slavery.
Sure.
Creation itself is going to have its Exodus.
Mm-hmm.
So I
agree with that. I think it's very hard to get Trinitarian theology out of the Exodus, Tom. It's really easy to get out of the Akita, then.
I'm not saying I'm getting it out of the Exodus. I'm saying in Paul's retelling of the Exodus narrative, Jesus and the Spirit play the role that in the original Exodus narrative is played by Yahweh himself. And that's how the story works.
Could I ask you how much is at stake for you in claiming that Paul is intentionally creating this structural parallelism between the Exodus narrative and the way he sets up the argument in Romans 6 to 8? How much of that could be a kind of analogy that is, I'm groping for the words I want to use here, that he has, you know, in certain of his phrases, some of his language, that some of these sort of fleeting echoes may occur of the Exodus story, but that he hadn't worked it out systematically in the way that you've just described. What would you think of that? What's wrong with that way of reading the evidence?
Not bold enough.
Yeah.
I think I said in something I wrote earlier that exuberant writing demands exuberant exegesis. If we have less than exuberant exegesis, it must be wrong, because this writing is absolutely explosive, and that's one of the reasons we are all so excited about Romans, as we should be. But that's not to say that every wacky idea is right. It's just to say that I think for Paul we can see all sorts of things which point to this. Particularly for me, it's when I look at some of the other Jewish writings of the day, for instance, the Wisdom of Solomon, which when it moves into its final great sequence, it is clearly an Exodus story. It's a retelling of the Exodus, but not for, as it were, purely historical reminiscence, but in order to say, this is the sort of God we have, this is the sort of stuff he does. So watch out, you rulers of the nations, because this is how our God judges the wicked pagans and does this and does that. And I see this in several Second Temple texts, and this retrieval of the Exodus narrative. The other thing is that it is the fulfillment of what God said to Abraham at the end of Genesis 15. And Genesis 15 is the text which structures both Galatians 3 and Romans 4, as I suspect we would all on this panel be agreed. It's hard to disagree with that. At the end of Genesis 15, God says to Abraham, Genesis 15 is all about the family and the inheritance. And God says, this is how your family will get the inheritance, through the Exodus. So after Romans 4, okay, this is where we are. We have Adam and Christ, as this is the big picture, but then the way in which that works out is, as you would expect, through the new Exodus. That's surely a great Jewish theme on which Paul draws.
I'm still wondering what's at stake. That's a long answer, but an exuberant reading. There are lots of different exuberant readings.
Of course, that was.
And that other Second Temple Jews may have had this Exodus narrative doesn't tell me still what's at stake.
What's at stake is ultimately the coherence of this text in terms of the rich coming together of themes, which isn't just Paul tossing extra ideas in because he happens to have them in his mind, but because actually they all do fit within this idea of the new Exodus, which is the great Isaianic idea. He's obviously drawing on Isaiah a lot in Romans and elsewhere. And also, well, I'm just going to say, it's also to do with a basic Jewish method of saying, this is how the God of all the earth is rescuing his creation. The answer is through the Exodus.
Well, let me jump in there, and maybe I could bring Ross in at this point, and maybe he'll have the last word on this topic before we move to another, because we have lots of things we want to talk about. But I might have said that one of the strongest arguments for your position is one that you didn't really make until you just mentioned it now, which is the central significance of Isaiah 40 to 55. If you look at the intertextuality of Paul's citation practice, Isaiah 40 to 55 shows up with much more frequency than most of the other texts we've been talking about here. Mm-hmm. And of course, that is a text about the end of exile and the return of Yahweh to Zion.
And the new Exodus. Yeah.
And now whether Paul, you know, sort of sees that as a master narrative, that's a little different from saying the Exodus narrative is the plot. It's saying that the prophecy of Isaiah is the plot. Yeah. But you know, Ross Wagner has written on Isaiah and Paul. I'd be interested in him getting in here.
Between giants here. I guess I want to come at this just a little bit differently. I think your idea about the return of the Lord to Zion, it makes certain texts pop for me in a really interesting way.
Pop is a good word.
Pop in a good way.
Yeah, yeah, good.
In a good way. Although I'm struck that when Paul talks about where is God now, yeah. It's in the community. You are the temple of God.
Absolutely.
God dwells with you. So he doesn't particularly seem to me to have an interest in the Jerusalem temple in his letters. The communities become the temple. But this is maybe another way of asking what's at stake. I have reluctance, I think, to follow you that there is a kind of Second Temple master narrative that everybody sort of sees. You know, God hasn't come back yet. And I might just cite Jesus of Nazareth, who says, not to be smart aleck, but why not? Who says, you know, you Pharisees have this habit of kind of hedging your oaths. And he says, how can you swear by the temple? And yet, don't you realize when you swear by the temple, you swear by the one who dwells in it? Mm-hmm. Now, he goes on in the next sentence to say, when you swear by heaven, you swear by the throne of God. Mm-hmm. So I don't think Jesus thinks God is located specifically in the temple and nowhere else. But, you know, we have a whole, from the second temple until its destruction, and well past, because Josephus certainly thinks that the temple is going to be rebuilt, I think. You have priests following the laws, guarding the sanctity of the temple. It's a tremendous offense when Antiochus walks into the Naas, the holy place. Just because there's not a sort of recapturing of the, one might even say, the kind of mythical picture from 2 Kings, do we really think that the priests, that the people who came on pilgrimage to Jerusalem, Jesus himself, that they thought God wasn't there?
No, I mean, it's a good question, and you could have cited other things as well about when you bring your gift to the altar and so on, that in Matthew Jesus seems to assume that people are continuing to do the worship in the temple, and he doesn't say, what a waste of space. And I think part of our problem there is that, and I may be guilty of precipitating this accidentally, is that we tend in the modern Western world to have this kind of binary, either he's there or he isn't there. And what I'm saying is that it's a perception which continues right through to the rabbinic period, that it was a puzzle that the Shekinah was not there. And, you know, I don't think that's a, when I've talked to rabbinic scholars, like just happened to talk to Philip Alexander about this earlier this week, he agreed, yeah, that's right. Nobody thought the Shekinah had come back. And nevertheless, it's the place of pilgrimage, it's a place where God, as it were, has promised to put his name, and so since the divine presence is always going to be a kind of elusive thing, you go on doing this, just like, as I say, people go and pray at the Western Wall today, because it is the place which has been hallowed and sanctified by the presence of God. And I think any theology of sacred place has to do business with something like this, that it is mysterious, it is elusive, and so it isn't a straight either or. However, those very vivid prophecies from Isaiah and Ezekiel do seem not to leave room for a generalized sense of elusiveness, but rather they do envisage in plain sight. I mean, Isaiah 52 is very clear about that. And you know, so...
Can I ask you, though, as you continue to read on in Isaiah, you get a text that's quoted by Stephen in Acts 7 that says, God doesn't dwell in temples made by human hands,
of course,
right? So,
of course.
It just seems to me that it's, and maybe I don't still quite understand in which way it's significant for you, that First Peter says that the Spirit of God dwells on you. Mm-hmm. You are being built into a house, mm-hmm. which I think mm-hmm. is temple imagery. Sure. Paul has the community as sure. temple, or a text you quoted from 2 Corinthians about glowing with the face of Christ, or the glory of God in the face of Christ. I guess, why do I need this narrative about God returning to Zion when the New Testament seems, in a sense, to skip over any kind of return to Zion or to the temple, and instead sees Jesus located in the community?
I think it's a both and, like so many things are. But certainly at the beginning of Mark, as I said before, you've got two of the most obvious scriptural texts quoted about the return, one from Isaiah 40, one from Malachi 3, and then we're introduced to Jesus. That seems to me very clear. In Luke 19, you have Jesus saying, all this will come upon you because you did not know the hemera episkepsios, so the day of your visitation, which most translators and commentators think is the divine visitation. This is what it looks like when the visitation happens. And as Amos says, it'll be a day of darkness, not of light. So that I do think it's a strand which is important there in other bits of the New Testament. But then, yes, of course, for Paul, it is about the temple being reconstituted as a people. And I think that's in there in Romans 8 as well. Romans 8, 9 to 11, where the Spirit indwells you. And if you look up the enoikuntos root in the Septuagint, the enoikeo, the idea of indwelling, is a God dwelling in the temple theme. So, that kind of all fits.
Okay, well, I'm going to move us along. As you can see, there's not exactly full agreement on this particular thesis. But what's interesting to me is that one thing that there is agreement about, I think, among the participants on this panel, is that Paul's language is densely allusive and involves an evocation of a lot of different motifs out of Israel's scripture, and that whatever the proper interpretation of it is, it has to do with working out in some way which scriptures are at work and in what way, and in what are the underlying narratives that are being evoked in Paul's discourse. Could we agree on that?
Yeah, and I think we all agree that Jesus is right at the center of it, too.
Yeah, we do agree on that.
That's also a big piece,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we do agree on that. Okay. Yeah. All right, well, we're going to move to another question now, and I'm going to turn here to Professor Campbell and ask you, Douglas, if you'd like to pose the question we were talking about over dinner about starting point.
Starting point, yes. I've been thinking a lot about this just the last few days and weeks, because I'm an apocalyptic reader of Paul. And what I mean by that is that I think we've got to understand that for Paul, the truth is a revelation of Jesus Christ that comes and is under the control of Jesus Christ. So for Paul, I would argue Christ is literally the presence of God in a human being, mediated to him in the power of the Spirit. So his understanding of where he stands and who he is and who everybody else is fundamentally Trinitarian, right there in the middle. Okay? And what I want to say is that's where you start your analysis of Paul and nowhere else. Because if that's true, it affects everything else. It affects your understanding of history, because this sort of God is involved with you. And I would raise the stakes a little bit and say, I recognize in Paul what some theologians, one in particular, has said later on, that he was Swiss, by the way, if you step outside of that revelation as your starting point, you fatally compromise the church's understanding of truth. Fatally compromise it. And you undermine the very thing that you stand upon. So the stakes are fairly high here. When you move away from that starting point, you screw the whole thing up. Okay, have you got that? Right. So when you read Paul, there are 101 different ways you can screw this up. But apocalyptic readers of Paul, he said, in a non-inflammatory way, have got this, okay? And need to hang on to it, okay? And defend it against anybody that suggests other things, okay? There we are. Do you want me to give a little bit more?
Okay.
Not that I'm being provocative or anything.
Yeah. Dr. Eastman.
I'll just piggyback on a little bit. Somebody else who's schooled in an apocalyptic reading of Paul. When Paul describes his own call in Galatians, he describes it as an interruption that he thought He had a narrative going. He had an understanding of what it meant to be a faithful Jew, obedient to the law. He was really worried that this Jesus movement was going off track in some way from that narrative. And he describes it as an interruption. He didn't reason his way to it. He didn't derive it from a pre-existing understanding. He has to make sense of it again in relationship to his pre-existing understanding. But he does that in opposition as well as in continuity. So if we take Paul's description of how he got his gospel at his word, it is by this, and the term is an apocalypse. When God was pleased to apocalypse his son, I read it as in me.
Preach it, sister.
But both of you are saying this as though it is perhaps in counterpoint with what Professor Wright has written. Is this true?
And speak for himself.
It's a question of how one thinks theologically.
It's a question of method and what the internal logic of progression is in theology. Well, if I may characterize what I think the debate is about, I think that Tom is often read as arguing for something more like a kind of continuous process of salvation history, which comes to a kind of clean and logical climax in the cross and resurrection in a way that's not so interruptive as what you've just described. Is that right?
Yeah. Yep.
Is that the critique?
It depends what you're doing with history.
Yeah.
It depends if you're beginning with history and arriving at a revelation, or beginning with a revelation and in the light of that, giving an alternative account of history. But I think you actually do that for some of the time. I think you're a little ambivalent here, Tom. I'm going to ask you tonight to step out of the apocalyptic closet.
It's fascinating to me that we've had a clear admission, all but the name in question, that the word apocalyptic now basically means Bartian, because I actually think
I'm cool with that.
I know you're cool with that. Bart changes over time, B, because the word apocalyptic is so systematically contested, as we all know. I incline with those like Chris Rowland and Richard Borkham, who say that it's much better to retain the word apocalyptic for a literary genre rather than for a theological scheme, not least because I observe in the writings of, let's just list the most obvious suspects, Kaiserman, then Becker, then Martin, then De Boer, then Douglas himself, the word apocalyptic actually does change in meaning visibly and cannot be tied to one single scheme. It means different.
I don't think that's right.
You do think that's right?
No, I don't.
Oh, well, that's another discussion which we could have.
I know what I wrote.
I'm just saying that it's slippery when used as a term for theology, and particularly when the modern German or English word apocalyptic or apocalypse, which has its own history in the recent history of New Testament studies, particularly since late 19th century Germany, is assumed to be present when the Greek word apocalypse or its cognates is found in one of Paul's texts. That seems to be a very tricky bit of slippage, that actually Paul has got to have a word that says reveal, and the Greek word for that is apocalyptia.
What would you call the Bardian program? What would you call it? If you don't want to call it apocalyptic, what would you call it?
A Bartian reading of Paul.
Yeah.
I would call it a Bartian reading of Paul.
What would you call a dynamic? Would you call it revelational? Are you happy with revelational?
Yeah. Well, again, the word.
Let's get a word that you're happy with.
Yeah.
What would you like? You don't want any word. Choose a word. Choose a word.
This time of night. And let me be clear.
Well, we've got a lot to choose from.
If I can get a word in edgeways while all this is going on. I agree with the sentiment expressed in Colossians 1 and John 1 that the Messiah is the image of the invisible God, Colossians 1, and that in John 1, no one has ever seen God, but Jesus, the only begotten Son, has revealed him. In other words, I think both John and Paul are saying that human beings in general have an incoherent, fuzzy notion of who God is, and that when you actually
that out of John 1.
No one has ever seen God, but that Jesus...
No one's ever seen him, and we haven't seen him, right?
But Jesus has revealed him. In other words,
yes.
In other words, over, and so this is how I go about agreeing with that which was agreeable in what you said, namely
the true bit.
Yeah. It's in Jesus that everything else becomes clear.
Right.
But it's important to put it like that because when I read the ancient Jewish apocalypses, whether it's 1 Enoch or 4 Ezra or whatever, again and again I do see that there is a chronological sequence, which you get already in Daniel, obviously, in Daniel 2 and Daniel 7, that there is stuff which is going to happen, whether it's a rise and fall of particular empires or whatever, and at the end of that sequence God is going to do the radically new thing that he's promised. In other words, let's forget any idea of a Hegelian imminent developmental scheme which is just a steady crescendo. I have never said that. Actually, I don't think even Oscar Kuhlman said that, though he's often credited with it. That's just a smear tactic to try to avoid the point that in Jewish apocalyptic there is a backstory. And the way it works is this, that with a biblical apocalypse, God acts dramatically, shockingly, startlingly, as he always said he would. And somehow we have to hold those two together. And it's not a matter of saying it's either a steady state progression or just one big bang which sweeps everything off the table already. One of the key verses here is Galatians 4:4, when the time had fully come. And Paul uses the word chronos there, not kairos, and that cannot be dismissed, as some have tried to do, because what he's doing is still exegeting the Abraham narrative, which has to do with a set period of time after which, guess what, the new Exodus will occur.
Posing a false alternative, Tom.
Sorry?
You're posing a false alternative.
I don't think it's me that's posing a false alternative.
I am
actually posing an actual coming together, because I want to reclaim some sort of biblical idea of apocalypse, but I don't want to say that it involves the dismissal of everything that's gone before.
It doesn't.
But that is the false alternative.
Let me explain how it works. Jesus is God incarnate. That changes everything, okay, from the point of view of our perception. So now that we understand that Jesus is God and is included in the identity of God, we have to then retrospectively realize, with a new understanding, what creation and history and Israel were always all about.
Well, this is more or less what I've argued in many places.
Yes.
I mean, if that's your
that
problem,
is my position, and I think that's Susan's position. I actually think it's Lou Martin's position.
Yes, well,
that's how I read him.
This is a discussion that we ought to have on another occasion, and will have on other occasions, actually, because this would get into the detail of what different scholars have said at different stages. I agree that that is one of.
But you're happy with this, right? Hmm? You're happy with this proposal.
I'm not happy with the proposal that is a complete account of what Lou Martin
is doing.
Okay,
but you're happy with the account that I gave of a retrospective perception.
I'm happy with it as an overall systematic kind of several stages up from the text account.
What about right in the middle of the text?
It depends which text you're talking about, clearly.
Well, a lot of them.
And I think, I mean, let's go back. You raised the question at the beginning.
So you're not
the
happy with it.
You raised the question at the beginning and the starting point. Were you trained as a lawyer, Doug?
No, I'm a New Testament scholar.
Oh,
which is even worse.
No, you're a systematic theologian, actually. But I think the question of the starting point is an interesting one, because there's the question of Paul's starting point, which you, Susan, were talking about. And, okay, Paul is believing that he's got to persecute the church, and something happens and he discovers, actually, we were going in the wrong direction, and so on. But when Paul explains things to people, and when any of us explain things to people, we don't necessarily follow the same order that we came to our own understanding by. We do it differently according to who we're addressing and where we want to bring them from.
I think it's the
missing the point, Tom. It's an epistemological claim about truth claims and their status, and you're segueing into psychology and rhetoric.
No, I'm saying that, that at least one of you, I forget which, did talk about how Paul came to his view, and I'm agreeing with that, and I'm saying that then... yes, I totally agree with the epistemological point, as I shall be trying to say tomorrow, I hope midday, if I'm still awake or have woken up by then, that for Paul, there is a new sort of knowing because new creation has begun in Christ, as a result of which, as he says in 1 Corinthians 2 or 2 Corinthians 5, many other places, that there is, it's not just new objects of knowledge, it's actually a new mode of knowing. At this point, I think I'm completely up with Lou Martin and apocalyptic antinomies and all that.
There's no problem here, really.
There's no problem there. There are other problems, both with the exegesis and with the larger construct. But
I do think that there's... I mean, this is fun, isn't it? But this is quite interesting, because I do think there's a convergence here around a question about the epistemological centrality of Christ as determinative for how we ought to read Paul's thought. You would agree with that, right?
Of course, yes.
And the question is whether that epistemological centrality is compromised by the weight that your account of narrative and the narrative of Israel gives to creation and covenant. Is that the question?
I mean, I'd like to invoke Ed Sanders here. I mean, you know, Ed Sanders, who used to teach here, as most of you know, made the major point that Paul's thinking, and this is the point you were making, okay? Paul's thinking is from solution to plight, and he goes to Galatians 2. If Christ, you know, if righteousness is according to the law, Christ died in vain, it's through the law. He might structure an argument differently than that, but his logic, and that means the whole construction of what the gospel is, derives from the solution that makes him reread everything else.
Yeah, now obviously that was one of the major turns in the beginning of the so-called New Perspective when Sanders made that claim. After generations of everybody thinking first you have to discover how sinful you are and then guess what, you discover that Christ has died for you, that Sanders did it the other way around. And that was part of his apologia for Paul being actually not as negative about Judaism as one might have thought, because he says Paul finds Christ on the road to Damascus, or is found by Christ, and therefore deduces there must have been a problem, there must have been something wrong with the Torah, I'm not sure what, but anyway, there we are. This is what Paul finds wrong with Judaism, it is not Christianity, Sanders' famous line towards the end of the book. Now, what I've tried to do in the second half, or last bit of chapter 9 in this book, is to nuance that significantly by saying that, of course, every first century Jew who has any wits about them, and certainly a Pharisee, knows perfectly well that there is a massive problem, that we are longing for God to do the great act of deliverance which he's supposed to do and hasn't done yet, and we can see that right through the apocalyptic literature and lots of things going on, Josephus, the way he writes about that time and so on. And then my claim is that in the gospel, Paul does get this fresh revelation, but it's not out of the blue that there's a problem. He's not walking around prior to that thinking, no problem at all, and suddenly here is Jesus, so, oh, I must have had a problem. What I think we know quite a bit about first century Pharisaism, and I think Paul was right in the middle of that, and I think then what happens is that the revelation of Christ revolutionizes the idea of the problem he's had already. So he starts with problem A, then you get the revelation, and he ends up with problem B, which is the Christological and pneumatological reworking of problem A. You ought to like that, actually.
I like the second bit. Yeah, that was good. But I'm a little worried about the first bit that you pulled through. Why does Israel still have to have a self-evident problem with the law? Why do they have to fail? Why can't they just have a plight and wait for God to show up? Why do we have to have Israel wandering around, failing in its task to take the law to the world, heaping up sin upon themselves, which the Messiah arrives and takes upon himself, and bloody blah, blah. Why do we have to go there?
Can I jump in real quick? It seems to me that one of the... I'm sort of the Methodist in the middle here, wanting just everybody to join hands, right? Two of us, right?
This is a Methodist school, isn't it?
I don't think these are unimportant things. I guess I would want to emphasize again that I hear you both saying very similar things, but there may be something really at stake in where the weight is put. That is that because Paul believes that God is truly present, visible, manifest in Jesus Christ, he's got to rethink a lot. But he also knows who God is before this point. And he knows a lot about who God is. This is the God who made promises to Abraham. This is the God who is the God and Father of Jesus Christ, the God who made the world. So there's a sense in which there's a deep desire for continuity in Paul. I would want to nudge closer to Douglas and Susan and say, for Paul, the question of continuity really ultimately has to do with the faithfulness of God. Mm-hmm. And that partly it's perhaps rhetorical, but when one wants to kind of then tell the story from creation to eschaton in an orderly way, you have to fill in a lot of gaps that I think Paul never fills in. Yeah. So I imagine Paul thinking out from the cross and saying, okay, how does God's promise to Abraham, we've got people running around saying they're seed of Abraham, children of Abraham, how does that fit? Somewhere else he thinks about, well, what about Adam? I don't see in Paul's letters a nicely worked out story that kind of gives you, you know, five acts or other ways you very powerfully framed it. There's a Christian story, there's a canonical story. But does Paul need to do that? What's at stake for in this discussion between emphasizing Christ as sort of the center point out from which Paul thinks, in which certain continuities like the character of God are crucial, versus a kind of story that one could somehow read from page one to the last page?
Yeah, I mean, Paul obviously nowhere spells out the big story, but when you, as I've tried to do and as others here have tried to do, when you get inside so many elements of Second Temple Judaism and see how they retell the story and how they frame it, then when you see what Paul does with Abraham, with Adam, so many lights go on, so many things, you say, actually, yeah, this is what's happening. That then every exegete, okay, let me start the sentence again, every exegete has to assume some kind of subtextual narrative which makes sense of what's going on. For most Western Christians, until comparatively recently, the narrative went, God made the world, we messed it up, God sent Jesus, that's all right then. And then people say, then why was there an Old Testament? What was all that? Oh, it's types and shadows and promises and so on. And actually, that's just a radically modernizing and de-Judaizing reading of the New Testament, over against which I want to say, whether you read Josephus or 4th Ezra or whatever, you've got the great Jewish story, which is about the God who made the world sending Abraham to begin the process of sorting it all out. That's my favorite quote from Genesis Rabbah. You know, God says, I will make Adam first, and if he goes wrong, I'll send Abraham to sort it all out. And that's okay, 3 centuries after Paul, but that's basically that. That is a profoundly Jewish way of reading the whole of Israel's scriptures. And then when I see Paul working with Abraham and Adam in a way which fits, I think, so well into that kind of implicit narrative, I say, actually, I prefer this implicit narrative to the modern Western one, which is all about, oh dear, I'm a sinner, and so what's going to happen? Well, something funny happens about Jesus and the cross. I prefer the Jewish story to that.
I want to move this forward a bit. We've had a nice airing out of different views on this, but I want to ask Dr. Wagner, because again, in our actual dinner table conversation a little earlier, he had an interesting way of posing the question about what's at stake in this continuity with Israel question in relation to Jews and Gentiles in the church. Could I ask you to
let me just say one thing I really like about the book is your attempt to really take seriously Paul's own commitment to founding communities of worship. And at least some of them appear to be trying to bring Jews and Gentiles together in ways that were awkward, let's say, in the diaspora around a common table, around concerns about Gentile idolatry in infecting the purity of Israel. And maybe just to invite you to say, what is the importance, do you think, for us as scholars of Paul or as theologians interested in Paul, to take seriously the concrete telos of so much of his effort, that is, communities of Jews and Gentiles worshiping together.
Yeah.
How does that make some of these ideas we've been throwing around look different, do you think?
I think it's absolutely central. I'm grateful for you framing the question that way. For me, one of the things which made me read Paul differently was when suddenly, a long time ago, I had this sense that that was what Galatians 2 was about, that I'd always read Galatians 2 as about sin and salvation. Actually, salvation is never mentioned in Galatians, and sin is hardly mentioned at all. Galatians 2 is all about who can you sit down and eat with, and the whole thing is driven by that. And the question is, here are these Gentile sinners. If we sit and eat with them, are we sinners as well? Does that make the Messiah an agent of sin? Absolutely not, because what God has done in the cross is precisely to break down the barriers and to generate instead, as he says in Paul says in Ephesians, that's another question we might ask about Ephesians, one new humanity in place of the two. So it seems to me Paul's vision is of a community which symbolizes the truth which it professes to believe. That is, that in the Messiah, Israel's God has done what he always said, which is to establish this prototype of a new sort of humanity in which ethnic divisions no longer play any significant role. So at the end of Galatians 3, neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, no male and female, all one en Christo Jesu. And if you are the Messiah's, then you are Abraham's seed, sperma, heirs according to the promise. So that this is how the family is now constituted or reconstituted. And hence the bit which you've written very movingly about in Romans 15, which is actually the climax of the theological argument of the whole letter, that the coming together of Jews and Gentiles in shared worship is the aim of the whole thing, because Paul's aim is always the new humanity which is symbolized by this community being like this. And I think you see this said in Philippians, but you see it actually also said rather graphically in Ephesians 3, that this new humanity of this sort is the sign to the principalities and powers that God is God and that Jesus is Lord and that they aren't. And that's why Paul, in every letter, again and again, is striving for reconciliation, is striving for unity. This is not an icing on the cake thing, as it's been in so much Western Christianity. Oh yes, if we've got a little bit of time, let's work at some unity on the side. For Paul, it's absolutely basic. People have sometimes said to me, if Paul could come back today, what would he be most surprised by in the church? And the answer straight away is he'd be most shocked by our total collusion with disunity. He just would, you know, he might understand that unity is difficult. What he wouldn't understand is how we've colluded with disunity and haven't thought it's particularly important.
I could underline that with relation to the confrontation with Cephas in Antioch Galatians 2. The thing that's always fascinated me so much is that when Cephas withdraws from table fellowship, the thing that Paul says about that is, I saw that they were not walking straight towards the truth of the gospel. The truth of the gospel is actually destroyed and undermined by the fracture of table fellowship.
And some people in opposing the so-called new perspective have said sneeringly that the new perspective is just all about table manners, whereas we old perspective people believe in salvation from sin and so on. And no, that the coming together at the table is the sign of the new thing that God has done. And that can only happen, this new table fellowship, if the cross has meant what it means for Paul, which is God's radical dealing with all that defaces and distorts and destroys humanity, so that this new humanity can come into being.
So here's the question then. What does that mean for the continued existence of a Jewish people in history that do not accept Jesus as Messiah and do not come to the one table?
Well, as you know, the place where Paul addresses this is Romans 9 to 11, obviously, and one cannot summarize Romans 9 to 11 in two or three sentences, but it seems to me what Paul does in that passage is a retelling of the scriptural narrative, focusing on the climax of the Torah's narrative, which is Deuteronomy 30. One of the things I found late on in the day when I was researching this book is a little passage in Josephus where he's talking about Moses writing or composing Deuteronomy 32, and people, I think, get put off because he says Moses composed it in Greek hexameters, which is such a weird thing to say about Deuteronomy 32, that people miss what he then says, which is that Deuteronomy 32 is a prophecy of things which were to take place, and Josephus says, which are taking place in our own day, which is an extraordinary thing. It means that Josephus is seeing the Pentateuch, not just as the backstory of Israel, but as the whole story of Israel. And it seems to me Paul is doing exactly the same thing. From Romans 9:6 to the end of 10, he is telling the story of Israel through the lens of Torah, showing that Deuteronomy 30 is fulfilled en Christo. And this is the point where I want to say very strongly, really, that if any Jew at any period of Jewish history really did believe that this person or that person or the other person was Israel's Messiah, then there is no question. If the Messiah has come, this is where God's purposes for Israel are being fulfilled. And people believed that about maybe Judas the Galilean. They certainly believed it about Simon Bar Giora during the war, 6670. They certainly believed it, some of them did, about Bar Kokhba in 132 to 135. If you think you found the Messiah, this is where God's purposes are being fulfilled. And any claim to messiahship is a claim that either you're with us or you're missing out on God's plan. So that to claim messiahship for anybody is necessarily to make a statement about the people who don't join in. Qumran did this with their sect. The rabbis, in a sense, are doing this when they write the Mishnah. This is what Judaism looks like. So John Levinson says, one of the great Jewish scholars of our day, that the most Jewish thing about early Christianity is its supersessionism. And I like that paradox. In other words, this is how people are thinking. So then in Romans 11, Paul is moving out into new territory. Nobody's been this way before. And he does so Christologically, thinking through what it means if Jesus is the shape of, and this is very much a Campbellish sort of point, if I can put it like that. He is trying to think.
I wouldn't if I was.
He's trying to think Christologically. I know it's dangerous territory. He's trying to think Christologically about Israel and its future. That's how it's here.
Just pick up on that. Let me just pick up on that. I agree with a lot of what you're saying, but I don't think that Paul erases unbelieving Israel. I think there's still a vital role played by unbelieving Jews. They're retained in their integrity quite clearly in his thinking in Romans 11 and Galatians 6. And I read your exegesis at the end of Romans 11 with attention, and I agree with some of it. Namely, there is a sense in which I think Paul is saying that all Israel will be saved. And this is not some miraculous thing that happens outside of Jesus, but I think his expectation is that Israel will be saved. Okay? But up to that moment, there is an integrity to historical Israel, even when they're not responding to Christ. And this is extremely important because they represent the unbeliever, the pagan, the outsider. And they're still at that point encompassed within the merciful purposes of God. I think that's exactly what he says.
Yeah.
They're still held within the mercy of God in that text. Yeah. So this is critical information. So we can't kind of throw Israel under the bus and claim that the church is simply the new Israel.
No, and you see, that's the caricature. That is the caricature. That's not what I was saying.
But you say that the church is new Israel, stripped of its symbolic practice, right?
I never use the phrase new Israel because Paul never uses the phrase new Israel. I think
they're just Israel.
Paul uses the phrase Israel, just like in 9:6.
Right.
He says, not
so
all
we're Israel.
Not all who are of Israel are in fact Israel. You see, it's very easy to caricature this and imply that this is a kind of ecclesial triumphalism. And it really isn't.
No, I'm not suggesting that.
Because for Paul, it is the community of Jews and Gentiles in Messiah. I think Paul would say, the Messiah is Israel in person. Jesus himself is Israel in person.
So what about unbelieving Israel?
Sorry?
What about unbelieving Israel?
Unbelieving Israel are held there with the hope that as he says in 11 following, that God is going to do fresh work with them too.
So they have integrity as Jews, right?
It depends. Well, you bring in the word integrity, which actually can smuggle in all sorts of things.
I like it. It's a good word.
It's a good word. Yeah, just like erasure, which you used before, is a bad word, which again is a caricature of certainly what I was saying.
Well, what I was referring to was the erasing of Jewish practices.
Well, Paul clearly believes that it's wrong for Gentile Christians to have to be circumcised.
What about Jewish Christians?
At the end of 1 Corinthians 9, there's that very interesting passage which some people have tried to say doesn't quite mean what you probably know the passage where he says to the Jews I became as a Jew, to those under the law I became as one under the law, not being myself under the law. So I don't think Paul wants to prohibit Jews from, say, circumcising their children. I mean, one of the standard ways people ask this question is, had Paul had a son, would he have circumcised him? That's an interesting question.
Acts thinks he would have.
Not necessarily, because he circumcises Timothy, but that's not held up as the example of what you must always do.
It's consistent with everything he says, Tom.
I'm not sure. This is where...
You're nervous about letting Jewish Christians into the church still practicing Jewish practices.
The problem comes when Jewish Christians in the church say, and this is Galatians 2, for goodness sake, when Jewish Christians in the church say, because these Gentiles are uncircumcised, cannot share table fellowship.
Yeah, fine. I'm perfectly happy for them all to have table fellowship.
But that already is for some Jews, would mean the erasure of Jewish practice, because...
I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about Jewish Christians still observing the Torah.
But exactly. And some would say at that time that to observe Torah would mean precisely not eating with Gentiles.
Well, the Gentiles can hang out with the Torah-observant Jews. It's not a big imposition. That's what the apostolic decree was all about.
I'm not sure you're hearing what I'm saying, that if Jewish Christians are going to eat with Gentile Christians, and if Gentile Christians are providing the menu as well as the venue, then Jewish Christians would actually have serious
difficulty. They would have a problem. Yeah, they would. Well, why can't the Gentile Christians go and eat from a Jewish menu? See, you and I have very different understandings of the diversity of the church. That's what I'm getting at. And it seems to me that if you don't create a space for Jewish Christians to observe the law with integrity, and create a space for unbelieving Jews to continue to observe the law. You're lowering the boom a little bit on
Douglas.
Let me jump in here. Paul says that he has anguish in his heart over his kinspeople who have not accepted the gospel.
They're meant to convert. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So it's not this is not a sort of, you know, oh, there are two ways and, you know.
No, I'm not saying that. It's an ethical claim, Richard. Yeah. It's a claim about ethics.
But Paul thinks there's something wrong, right?
Yeah. With what?
With the Jewish people who have not accepted Jesus as Messiah.
Yeah, no, I'm completely happy with that. It's an ethical
just
point.
Say, so now we have it. We have Jews and Gentiles who are now in Christ, and that's fine. I still think, as you know, Israel continues to refer to the Jewish people.
This is a detailed question.
Can
I just pick up what Richard said? Because it's not only 9:1-5, it's also 10:1 following. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is hinnos o thurston.
We're not debating that. We're debating ethics.
No, well, I disagree. You see, that is about salvation.
We're debating ethics and whether you can bring your ethnic practices fully into Christian fellowship. If we can't create space for Jews to live as Messianic Jews...
I haven't heard Tom say you can't do that. He does.
I've said that...
He does. Judaism is shorn of its symbolic praxis.
Well, because Paul says that you do not have to get circumcised. He said, and basically, Romans 14, he's reduced the status of the food laws within the church to saying, some of us are happy to eat only vegetables, some of us are happy to eat meat, so let not the one who does judge the one who doesn't. Right. But the point is that together with one heart and voice, you can glorify the same God.
Yes.
Now, so you need to put that alongside the end of 1 Corinthians 9, alongside the other...
Yes.
Yeah. But this isn't just about... You know, say it's about ethics. I don't think Romans 9, 1-5 or 10-2 are about ethics. They're clearly about salvation. That's why Paul is so upset, not because, oh dear, they're not quite...
No, changing the subject. I'm quite happy for Messianic Jews to be saved, non-Messianic Jews to be in trouble. What I want is a full ethnic expression of our particularity in the church. So the diversity that you spoke about so eloquently and so powerfully does not actually result in the imposition of a majority culture within the church that erases practices. That's a very important point.
I understand that, but in the middle of that phrase, erasing practices, there are some distinctions which are to be made, mm-hmm. because Paul would not say that all ethnic groups will bring their practices into the church. In Colossians, he talks about barbarian, Scythian, etc. Right. Now, the Scythians are famous for their hot temper in antiquity, and Paul says, sorry, bad temper and anger and so on, that's ruled out. If somebody says, hey, I'm a Scythian, this is my identity, don't erase it. Paul says, sorry, now you're in Christ. That's... What about the Corinthians, for whom famously sexual immorality is one of the things which... we're Corinthians, don't try and squelch our culture. And Paul says, sorry, now you're in Christ. That bit of your culture is out of line.
Yeah, I agree.
So it must be open to be said.
Yeah, you're sure. I don't have a problem with that.
For everybody.
Yeah, but we're not dumping our Jewish practices.
Time out. If anger and quarreling are supposed to be ruled out in Christ, we're going to again, we've identified an area of some disagreement requiring further discussion. But I want to move on to perhaps a last major question we wanted to talk about, and that's one that Professor Susan Eastman proposed that we talk about, and that's the question of the meaning of participation. Could you frame that question for us?
Sure. Well, all of you know that in Pauline interpretation, sometimes participation, the whole idea of participation as a mode of, as soteriology, a mode of salvation, gets played off against notions of justification as salvation and so forth. So I'd be interested, furthermore, how one thinks about participation, I think, plays into that oppositional binary. And one model is that participation is that human beings participate in Christ through the practices of the church and through baptism, through sacraments, and so forth, and thereby then are admitted into the people of God and then are saved. Another model would say that participation should be reversed. And by that, I mean that the participation that is salvific is God's participation in human history, in the history of Israel, but then above all in Christ. And so if one flips the categories of participation from an ecclesial category to a Christological category, then that potentially changes how we even think about participation. It does not then obviate human participation in Christ, but it changes the dynamics of that participatory union. And so I'd be interested to hear Tom's thoughts on that, because it's something you have in different ways written about, and I'd like to hear your thoughts.
I'd like you just to sharpen that up a bit, because the notion of participation in Pauline studies is usually tied to body of Christ and particularly to in Christ. And so are you thinking of particular passages or particular ways mm-hmm. in which Paul... Because the danger is when we talk about participation, we can expand the category and talk about mm-hmm. participation in God or God's participation mm-hmm. in our life or whatever, and then we may be moving into a larger construct which isn't necessarily something Paul discusses. Mm-hmm. Could you sharpen
the... Sure, of course, the language is the prepositional.
Yeah.
In Christ in me, language. Yeah. But it's also another place for talking about this would be Philippians 2.
Okay.
And the whole basic soteriology, Christology, that God has entered human flesh and fully entered into human existence to the point of death as a slave crucified criminal. That level of that, I would say that is something that one could talk about as participation And then that would, and then Paul goes on to talk about, so what that means is that, you know, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. God is the one working, the willing and the working in you. That's another place where you get that whole idea of a divine participation in the human realm.
I mean,
and what does that do?
There's a long history in Pauline studies of some people saying that Christ in me and me in Christ is actually just a different way of saying the same thing, over against other people saying, no, actually these are quite different, and they both matter, but they're different. And I'm one of those who says that they're different, that they're not interchangeable. And I think where you, obviously being in Christ as opposed to Christ in us is much more common in Paul, but where you do get Christ in us, for instance, towards the end of Galatians 2, it means something very particular, which can't just be collapsed into a general idea of a sort of participation.
I would agree with you about that.
But I mean, what interested me in one of my more recent trawls through the relevant material is that in three places, one in Galatians, one in Romans, one in Philippians, Paul talks about being justified in Christ, implying that these are not actually two separate schemes, as from Schweitzer onwards, and in fact before Schweitzer, has often been thought. And so I think what Paul is doing is talking about God's action in the Messiah as the basic primary thing, and through that action in the Messiah, God is, to use the legal language of Romans, announcing the verdict, the law court verdict over Jesus, and then over those who belong to Jesus by extension, so that those who come to be en Christo have the same thing said of them that God has said of Jesus in anticipation of the final judgment. That would be a Romans thing, and I'm deliberately trying to wake Douglas up again, which I think I'm succeeding in doing, which is good. But then the way that then plays out, I'm perfectly happy to say that, of course, Paul then talks about Christ in, well, Colossians 1, Christ in you, the hope of glory, but
Christ in you, plural.
Yes, but I was thinking of Galatians 2, where I am crucified with the Messiah, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but the Messiah lives in me. And that is a statement about who Paul now is in himself, with the indwelling Messiah, and hence, yes, in Romans 8, 9 following, that if the Messiah is in you. So, but these are not the same thing, and I'm slightly worried about using the word participation in a way which covers those and other things, lest we slide too quickly and hence miss the specifics of the particular passage. I'm not saying you're doing that, but that's just a danger I see.
What's at issue is the question of whether it's... I mean, Sanders used this term a lot,
and he talked
about it as a transfer term.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, we transfer into, and in that sense, then it depends on a human action, in a sense, a human movement into Christ. So what's at issue in this way of talking is God's action as that which saves.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very hard to read Paul as saying anything other than God's action is the thing which saves. I think one of the problems with Sanders' reading is precisely because he talks about transfer terminology and he has these big categories of getting in and staying in. And I'm not actually sure that getting in and staying in is terribly relevant to what's going on in the ancient world as a whole or for Judaism. I mean, people usually aren't getting in or struggling. That's not, those aren't the big categories. I think that's actually, despite Sanders' big intention, a retrojection of yet more comparatively modern categories into the ancient world. So I think that's...
One of the problems with Sanders' account of that is that he thinks that the way the transfer takes place is by the human action of having faith.
Right.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Yeah. Whereas I think most of us here at least would agree, no, actually when Paul uses this pistis Christou language, that he's actually talking about Christ's faithfulness, which is incorporative in the way you're describing, right?
We haven't said much yet about the Spirit, but it strikes me, just looking at Romans 8, that there's this, the way in which Christ is in us, Paul can speak about the Spirit of God's Son being sent into our hearts. Mm. Just an interesting use of justice language or righteousness language.
He says, if Christ is in you, your body is dead on account of sin, but the spirit is life on account of righteousness. And the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead, if that spirit dwells in you, then the one who raised Jesus from dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the spirit who is indwelling in you, which actually comes back to the whole temple theme, right? And oikoutes.
Hang on.
Well, I don't want to lose this point, though, that Sanders talked about a transfer because he's working with this big scheme about getting in and staying in, but it seems that Paul, we are in agreement that because God has entered human flesh, not only in Jesus, but through the Spirit into our human body, corporate body, individual body, then everything is new. Life from the dead is worked out this way, right?
As long as the Spirit is being invoked strongly. So the Trinitarian dynamic, we're gathered by the Spirit into Christ who reconstitutes our humanity. I think that's exactly right. But this is my point. We're all talking about participation, but there's a critical issue here that needs to be identified, which goes to the heart of a lot of the things we've been talking about, which is which story are we using to structure our new situation, our new reality in Christ? What is it? What narrative do we actually inhabit? And very, very important issues are at stake here, because there's a long history in the Western tradition, the Western theological tradition, a long split with a group of people who interpret our relationship with God in fundamentally political and legal terms, and a tradition that interprets our relationship with God in fundamentally filial categories. Quote, sonship, unquote. I have to gender that, but what we're talking about is children. Families, parents, people who love one another and are intimate with one another. And depending on which narrative we bring to bear, whether it's the New Exodus or whether it's Abraham and Isaac, our understanding of what it is we're involved with is going to be very different. And what I would want to argue quite enthusiastically is we're in a filial relationship with God. We're involved in a family. We're involved with a father or a mother who loves us. We're involved with a son. We're involved in relationships that need to be understood primarily out of a family context. They're unconditional relationships. They're loving. Okay? Which means that we must restructure our understandings of what is legal and just and political. So the push comes from being involved with God into a reconstruction, a renewed understanding of these legal relationships that can be very harsh. But what has happened is we've inserted these other categories into our understanding of our relationship with God. And that's the importance of the apocalyptic starting point. That's where we turn around.
Surely both of those narratives are present in Paul. Both of them are there.
No.
Yeah, the legal,
yes
the,
no.
the
one is doing the work.
The juridical and the familial are
one
both there.
Well, I've done a lot of work on the juridical narrative.
Yeah.
And I think what I'm really trying to say is we need to understand our notion of justice in the light of the cross. So we need to let the theology of the cross reconstruct our understanding of justice. That's incredibly important. Now, I can smell someone who's not doing this underwater at 50 yards.
Do you have any smells right now that you
want? I won't name names.
Quick word on this, and then we're going to go to a concluding point. Yeah.
In Galatians, Paul uses the language of dikaiosune, whether you're going to translate that justice or whatever, but not as, he doesn't develop a legal metaphor really at all. I think it's about the status of membership in God's people, and I think that's rooted in Genesis 15, which is about the promise to Abraham, and I think reckoned as righteousness there clearly has to do with being demarcated as a member of the covenant, and I've argued that elsewhere in detail. Paul is not using this in the sense of the legal metaphor that we find in Romans 2, 3, 4, etc. In Philippians, when he uses the justification language, he is not using the metaphor he uses in Romans. I think what's happened in Romans is that Paul, already familiar with this, develops the dikaiosune language, which both in Hebrew and in Greek can carry these different ranges of meanings, so that he brings in the law court image, but I would say that's fused with precisely the covenantal image, and the covenantal image is the one that generates then the filial relationship. And it's
the other way around.
This is why This is why the Dicasune argument of Romans is not only about Romans 1 to 4, it runs right the way through to the end of Romans 8, including the passage which Ross just quoted, Romans 8:10, and particularly in 8:31 to the end, where your Akedah thing, it's back to the law court. It's God who justifies, who is to condemn.
It's not a law court, Tom. It's not a law court. This is where Lou is helpful. A law court is a two-actor drama. In Romans 8, it's a three-actor drama.
Hebrew law court is a three-actor drama.
Romans 8 is a three-actor drama where you're being delivered from the clutches of an evil power. So the point is incarceration. Yeah. I'm imprisoned. I'm constrained, and God has set me free from these things.
Fine.
Okay? But this is not how law court metaphors work 99% of the time.
What I hear you doing is still running the sort of either-or that you have in Gustav Aulén's Christus Victor,
where you either have
a Christus Victor or a Latin view, but, you know...
I'm just doing good theology, Tom.
Yeah, okay.
Because Tom's a good... Because Paul's a good theologian.
The hour is moving on towards 9 o'clock, and what you've heard on this panel here tonight is a lot of detailed, passionate argument about how to interpret Paul's theology. And I hope you've found it as fascinating as I have. But I want to conclude our discussions by asking each of our panelists to answer the question, so what? Why do we care so passionately about how to interpret Paul? Why does Paul matter? I'm gonna go from this side to this side this time and let Douglas have the first rather than the last word on this. Douglas, you're up first.
Well, Paul was just a really cool guy. And he was a genius who understood what it meant to be a Christian in service to Christ. He outlined with extraordinary insight the basic truths of the Christian faith. He really got it right. And so I think we lose sight of that at our peril. But where we grasp the Pauline gospel with clarity, it is a very dynamic, liberating force in the life of the church and the life of people here. And he's a cool guy.
Okay, Susan.
I worked for many years as a pastor before I came back into the academy. I preached Paul. I have many times encountered both inside the church and outside the church people saying, better you than me. All I know about Paul is his bad press, and so forth. I also think that Paul's way of proclaiming Jesus is absolutely liberating, and it speaks to contemporary experience in such a radical and surprisingly, I don't like the word relevant, but it targets. And because of the ways in which he understands bondage, sin as incarceration or bondage, the ways in which he understands the gospel as liberation, the ways he understands human beings as constituted in relationships that are either destructive or life-giving, and the way in which Christ comes into our life. So I think he has a radical voice always in the church, but also outside the church.
Okay. Ross?
Do you want to answer it also?
Yeah. No, I'm the moderator.
Oh,
no.
Well, I don't disagree with anything that my colleagues have said, but I think for me, Paul is... I wouldn't claim he's the most important voice. I think of the New Testament writers as offering us a chorus of distinctive voices that ultimately at some level cohere with one another. For me, Paul is a bridge between the Gospels, the stories of Jesus, this compelling figure, and the communities that come into being trying to instantiate in very concrete circumstances what it means to be followers of Jesus. So, you know, where Paul is... I imagine sometimes with fear and trembling, imitate me as I imitate Christ. I find Paul to be a fascinating example of someone who tried to live a life in which Christ lived in him.
Yeah. I agree with everything that's been said here. I think one of the things that I'm struck by again and again is the way in which Paul lived at the confluence of several different worlds, so the Jewish world, the Greek world, the Roman world, but probably other bits of subculture as well, and somehow has the nerve and the courage and the intellect and the passion to engage with them all at once and to see them coming together and kind of to relish doing that. And during my lifetime, Western Christianity has sort of woken up to the fact that actually we live in a multicultural world, we live in a pluriform world, and to be able to see somebody who was living right in the middle of that and was announcing that Jesus is the Lord of that whole world, and that in Jesus, the God of Israel, the Creator God, loves the whole world and invites the whole world powerfully through the Spirit and the Gospel. That is an awesome thing. And I too worked for a long time as a pastor before I came back into the academy. And for me, one of the really striking things about Paul, and I didn't expect this to come out in the way that it eventually did in the book, is that again and again his arguments either come back explicitly or implicitly to love. What goes on in 1 Corinthians 13 is not a sort of aside about a nice little sort of fluffy bit on the side. This is absolutely central. It's to do with his doctrine of reconciliation. It's to do with the center of what he thinks humans are made for and what he thinks humans are made by. And actually, the faithfulness of God, another word for faithfulness is agape, God's faithfulness for his people, our faithfulness to one another. That vision of a human life which is suffused with, grasped by, sustained by the ultimate unbreakable divine love. I think Paul was the first person to articulate that, and he did so in the teeth of the most severe stress and opposition and suffering and pain. And I just think that's an amazing thing for which you should be grateful.
Douglas says maybe Jesus articulated that too.
Yes, he did. But yes, of course he did. Jesus not only articulated it, Jesus actually did it. That's why Paul says the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. But in the image I've often used, Jesus wrote the song. Paul was the first one to go out into the wider world and teach people from many, many different languages and cultures to sing it.
A nice summation. I think this panel has agreed on the importance and liberating power of Paul's message, and we've agreed that it has something to do with the reconstitution of humanity. A word that we haven't used very much tonight is resurrection, but surely if the discussion had moved into a chapter, into Tom's chapter on eschatology, we would have had much more to say about that as the ultimate hope, which is also so powerfully articulated by Paul. I want to thank members of the audience for sitting and listening to this animated discussion. If you are an undergraduate who happens to be here tonight, this is a little taste of what you might get if you happen to decide to come to theological school. And you can decide whether or not that's an attractive possibility. We think it's a lot of fun. And if you're not a Christian by chance in the audience, perhaps you might also say, there's something really at stake here that we ought to explore. I want to thank Professors Campbell, Eastman, Wagner, and Wright for a lively conversation. I want to invite everybody to come back at 12:30 tomorrow to hear Tom Wright speak about why and how Paul originated Christian theology. Thank you. Good night.